Let us pray. Our God and Father, we thank you for your holy word, your words of love, your words of life. We ask your blessing upon us this day as we hear them and we put them into our hearts and into our lives. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Well, friends in Christ, last week we heard the story of the Israelites getting to the Red Sea after all Pharaoh finally released them. But then he changed the mind. As they approach the Red Sea, they've got that on the east side of the entourage, and Pharaoh's army is coming with their chariots on the west. What's going to happen? And they cry out, and God comes. And he brings a pillar of fire to keep the army back. He opens up the Red Sea so that they can cross on dry land. And then he closes the Red Sea, and all of Pharaoh's chariot men are drowned. They're on the new side. They're on their way to the promised land, the land full of milk and honey. We just heard the song, "Thank You, Lord," and yet we hear nothing in the text, at least recorded, saying the Hebrew saying, "Thank you, Lord, for letting us have this freedom." They go a few days, and then they are unhappy with the water. And so they cry out to Moses. Moses talks to God. God says, "Tap your rod on this rock, and water will come." Good water came out and they were satisfied. Again, there's no listing in the scriptures about the people saying thank you. But instead, they continue. And so for a month or 6 weeks, they're continuing to the east and south because Moses is leading them to Mount Sinai to get the covenant, not knowing what it's going to be. And of course, we know it turned out to be the Ten Commandments. But they get so far, and they're out of provisions. They're in the desert, the wilderness. I'm hungry. So instead of praying to God and thanking Him for deliverance, they grumble, they complain, they bellyache. And we hear some of that this morning, but we also hear God's graciousness to them, His grace. The whole congregation of the Israelites set out from Elam. And Israel came to the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elam and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month after they had departed from the land of Egypt. The whole congregation of Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I am going to rain bread from heaven for you. And each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. And that way I will test them, whether they will follow my instruction or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gathered on other days." So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, "In the evening you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your complaining against the Lord. For what are we that you complain against us?" And Moses said, "When the Lord gives you meat to eat in the evening and your fill of bread in the morning, because the Lord has heard the complaining that you utter against him, what are we? Your complaining is not against us, but against the Lord." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, 'Draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining.'" And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked toward the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, "I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, 'At twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread.' covered the camp, and in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew was lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, "What is it?" Or sometimes referred to as manna, "What is it?" For they did not know what it was. But Moses said to them, "It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat." May God bless our hearing of his holy word. Amen. Grumble, grumble, grumble. Aren't they just like us today? Don't we just keep grumbling? Don't we just keep hearing people grumble and complain? You know, life is like the story of Goldilocks and Three Bears. It's too hot, too cold, too wet, too dry, too hard, too soft, too whatever. You know, we sometimes forget to say thank you, God. The song we had a few moments ago was a nice reminder to thank him for the things that we have. Family, friends, crops, opportunity to do things. Opportunity to serve. Thank you for the church. Thank you for his son Jesus who died for us. But it's easier to be negative. Oh, this world has all gone to heck in a handbasket. Well, it doesn't have to. But we can lift up our prayers to God. Instead of complaining to one another, we complain to God and say, "God, help straighten this mess out. Help us do the right things." In our text this morning, they're grumbling, they're hungry. Well, a person can live 3 to 4 weeks without food. Not comfortably, but they can manage. Food insecurity is a big issue in the world. There's food insecurity for the Israelites. And throughout history, groups of people have starved or had food insecurity. One of the things that the late Dr. Norman Borlaug founded was the World Food Prize that's handed out every year in Des Moines. He was the instigator, you might say, or leader of the Green Revolution, growing wheat to improve diets. And he shared the honor of Laura, who has done something to improve food security for some part of the world. And really some tremendous individuals receive that recognition. But in spite of all their efforts, there's still food insecurity for a variety of reasons. One of the things that I had fun doing this past Friday at Sioux City, our meeting, was that the Masons of the Iowa Masonic family has raised over $100,000 to give to the food banks of Iowa. And there are six regional food banks. Sioux City is the one that serves most of this area. One out of Des Moines serves Odebolt, and then there are others elsewhere. And so that $100,000 will be divided pro rata between the six districts. Jake, who accepted the donation, in his comments said this: $100,000 will buy 500,000 meals. Just think of that. With all the unemployment because of coronavirus, we have people that have had steady jobs that are out of work, their food insecurity. I bet I know where Marnie was this past Thursday, that she was in Gallup for the mobile food pantry.
Wearing my mask.
Wearing her mask, like a good girl. But how many people did you serve that, you know, quite a number of people needed food?
68 households.
We're doing a small part to help others. It's too big a problem to solve it all by us, but if we take a little piece of it, it makes a difference. And so, when they complain about not having enough food, maybe it doesn't affect us or we can't really relate to it. Just being an hour late for supper doesn't make you food starvation. But it's a big important issue in the world that people do have food. food security. And I think the church is being commended for its support of the food pantry system. And we can give thanks that we have people that care. But back to our text. Oh, goodness, I need an unknown caller. Why are they picking on me during worship? Anyway, because I don't normally have service in the church. I'll have to get it later. What we sometimes forget is God hears. Sometimes we think he should respond more quickly. After all, it took him 400 years to free the Hebrews from the slavery. But he does hear. But then he uses people, like you or I or whoever, that we are his extension. Just like we, like Marty is helping with the food bank, she is an extension of God's hands, along with many other volunteers. Now we sometimes forget that God, yes, we do know God creates miracles. But a lot of miracles are simply changing people's hearts so that they respond to others. The people that care. As I was talking to the confirmation youth this morning, you don't have to like somebody, but you still have to love somebody. You know, there are people that are really deep that you just don't want to be near. But that doesn't mean you don't love that person. That we're to care for them, you know, no matter how they've treated us, we're still to care, and we're to reach out. And then asking God for help changes our hearts. It may not change their hearts, but it changes our hearts. Moses was trying to get through the Lord, or the Lord through Moses. Listen to what God says. I'll provide manna. I'll provide meat. Trust me. And thank him. Don't just take it for granted. Thank him for the gifts of life. We need to lift up those that maybe we can't be in touch with because of the coronavirus, but we still can pray for them. Lift them up. In all things, will you thank God?